My name is Mark Ciperone, and I'm the manager of Miguel Cartagena. Now, in the sport of boxing, there are professional boxers, and then there are world-class athletes. Please allow me to introduce to you Miguel No Fear Cartagena, a world-class elite athlete in the industry of boxing. It is true that big things do come in little packages, so please enjoy this video. Thank you.
Miguel Cartagena, 21 years old. I'm a professional fighter, and I fight at super bantamweight or super flyweight, one or the other.
Started at 7 years old. I had my first amateur fight at 60 pounds. I was a little guy, a little bit smaller than I am now. I'm still a little guy, but you know, I grew a couple of inches.
I got Miguel in boxing when he was 6 years old. You know, we started. You know, I always seen he was real hyper. You know, and I said, I got to get this kid, you know, to calm down a little bit, because we tried football, we tried baseball, seemed like he couldn't get it. And one day I said, you want to go to the gym? He said, yeah. So always used to get in trouble with the kids in the block, always fighting and always trying to fight bigger kids than him. So I said, I gotta do something with this kid. So, you know, we got in the gym, and our first 2 years, you know, he's kind of like liked it, and he said, Dad, I'm staying. And that's how it started. You know, we started there. His first amateur fight was at 10 years old.
I fought in a diamond belt tournament. I was like about 2003, so I must have been like 10 years old, 10, 11 years old. Won my first fight, got my first trophy. I was excited, had something to show everybody for what I was doing so long. I was boxing since I was 7, didn't get no fights. So I was boxing, this was 3 years, no trophy, no nothing, no fight. Everybody's looking at me like I'm doing it for nothing.
These right here are some of my trophies. This is actually my very first trophy right here. I won this back in 2002. I won this trophy back in 2002. My very first trophy right here. It's pretty cool. Fought a guy named Jameer at Joe Frazier's gym. So I was back when it was open. It's closed now. It's pretty cool. This is pretty much most of them. It's not all of them. I'll give a lot of them away. Outstanding fighter of the whole tournament that year. She's pretty dope. These flags right here is from when I fought in Italy. These are my three best medals that I actually really care about. Pretty much the only ones that are actually pretty much important. This one right here is 2008 Junior Olympics. The first year I went out there, got a silver medal. One of my first major national tournaments that I've ever been to, and I was happy enough just placing silver. I was excited about that. This is another silver one I got the year after. So two silvers, not bad. And then this right here is I went to the USA Championships. One of the biggest tournaments an amateur boxer could possibly ever go to. Excited about this. I won gold my first year there. 16 years old. I was the youngest one to win it.
I won the Golden Gloves 7 times. I think I won it 5 years straight, and then I had lost 1 year, and then won another 3 years straight before that. So it was pretty cool fighting the Golden Gloves. It was always Pennsylvania Golden Gloves, because I was always a junior. Since I'm so young, I was always the junior, so I didn't get to go to the Nationals till later into my career. It was always only the state titles I would hold. I won it at 65 pounds, 80 pounds, 85. I was unstoppable at 85. I ain't lose a fight at 85, and I had a lot of fights at 85.
All right. Yeah, he started competing at 10 years old. So, I mean, every at that time, you know, Philly had a lot of matches, you know, and we, you know, fought a couple times in the matches that they had on Philly. you know. And then after that, I started, as I seen that he was getting better, I said, I'm going to have to start traveling with him, go to Washington, Virginia, any tournament that, you know, was there. I took off in my car, packed his bag, and took off, you know, with my little killer in the back of the car, you know. So, you know, he started, you know, getting there at the age of 16, you know, I seen a lot on him because I always, you know, when he was 14, he was sparring bigger guys. And at 16, I said, Miguel, let's turn open class, you know. And a lot of people said, no, it's too early to turn open class. You know, if he turns open class, he's gonna be competing with these grown men, you know, 28 years old, 30 years old. So I said, look, he has the skills to compete with these kind of people.
Right now, we at Huntington Park. It's where I run a lot. Well, that's where I do most of my running at. It's not really too many tracks in the hood. So that's why I run a lot here. It's quiet, especially at nighttime. It's more quiet, less cars. Might not be the safest place, but hey, gotta work with what you live with. Fought in a lot of different states in a few different countries. Fought in Florida, Puerto Rico, New York, Virginia, South Carolina, North Carolina, California. Fought in a lot of different places, in like 30-something, 40-something different states I've been to just for boxing. So I thank boxing for a lot of things I've accomplished, that I even went to different places. Countries I've been to England, been to Italy 3 different times, fought in Rome, Assisi, and where else about it? In Italy, in Bulgaria, I'm not sure how he's pronounced it, but I fought there too.
My name is Javier Varela, trainer of Miguel Cartagena. I've been training Miguel since the age of 10. His father brought him to me where I was in another gym, and at first I didn't want to train the kid because, you know, I had my own fighters, but his father asked me to train him, and we've been together ever since. Miguel always been a tough kid, always been a hard puncher, very dedicated to the sport. He's always want to fight, always want to win. So it was a good match between me and Miguel. And you know, rest is history, a lot of stuff going on with him. And at first it was hard because he was always the younger guy, the smaller guy, going up against bigger kids all the time. And he won a lot of national tournaments. First time I took him out to a national tournament, he didn't even know what a national tournament actually was. And I started explaining to his dad about going to the silver gloves, going to the different tournaments. Now, he medaled out in all major tournaments. Medaled out. If it was silver or gold, never brought home the bronze. Never.
Well, March 26, 2011, we decided to turn pro. We fought our first pro fight in Atlantic City, you know, under top rank promotion. So they gave us a real hard guy, you know, for his first pro debut. You know, they gave us he was left-handed. He had like 12 fights already, you know. And we wasn't even worrying about that he was left-handed. He had, because I already knew what Miguel could do inside that ring when he's well prepared. I always tell him, Miguel, if you're prepared, nobody could beat you. You know, and we surprised a lot of people that night too. You know, but they was like, wow, this kid, you know, just turned pro.
Named Gerald, aka Black Cartagena. How I met Miguel was from his sister. That's my girlfriend. She introduced me to him. It's funny how we met. I had the, he was selling his car, and I got this for sale signs for him. And, you know, they introduced us. I took a liking to him. I found out he was boxing. I seen a couple of his DVDs, his fights. And he's sharp, one of the best in Philly. I started following him, going to the gym. While he's doing his thing, I'm lifting weights. You know, we just kept at it. I'm motivating, keeping going, because I know he's good. And he got a lot of potential. And he got a good future, bright future ahead of him.
How y'all doing? My name's Dro. I'm Miguel's friend. I met Miguel about 2 years ago. He was a real close friend of my sister's. As time went by, I started working at a barbershop where he was getting his hair cut at. And we hung out a few times here and there. Started coming to the gym with him. I got to know him a little better. Pretty good kid, man. He kept me out of trouble. He real inspiring to me. I mean, I had times where I wanted to quit the barbershop and just leave it alone. And he would just always tell me how if I wanted to become a good barber, just to keep going with it and never give up. He supported me through a lot. You know, anytime I need him, I can call him at any given time. And he's just always there, man. He's a good kid, good skills. I mean, he's not a cocky boxer. But Miguel, when he's in the gym, he plays a big leader role here. He's always inspiring the other kids that's in here starting up. He's always helping them and teaching them new things. I mean, he's just not worried about himself all the time. I think that's what makes his personality so good, that he's good with others. He don't try to put nobody down. He's always encouraging the kids in here to, you know, work towards what they want, whether it's boxing, baseball, anything, any sport, college, whatever. Like, whatever it is, he always tries to, you know, keep them motivated enough to make sure that they not out in the streets doing anything wrong.
Right now, we had Philly Rumble's Boxing Club. I actually came up with the name on my way to a tournament back in 2004, 2005, I'm not sure. I was on my way to Virginia. No, I was on my way to Ohio, Cincinnati, Ohio. I was on my way to Cincinnati, Ohio, and the owner and my trainer and my dad, we were on the road with another fighter. They was always talking about getting their own gym, and it was just like, well, if we got a gym, what would we name it? Like, I don't know. At first, I thought of Philly Brawlers. I'm like, nah, it's too, it sounds funny. Philly something. And we thought about it, we were like, all right, we're going to name Philly Rumblers. Well, being an amateur and then becoming pros, it wasn't that big of a step. Like, everybody thought it was going to be, like, a lot harder for me to transition over. But to me, it was actually easier because I kind of always felt like I had an amateur style. Like, I knew how to fight, I'm saying, 10-point system. I knew how to, I'm saying, fight like an amateur, too. So it was like, whether I said amateur, I would have been doing fine. And if I turned pro, obviously I'm doing fine now. So I believe like I have what it takes to do everything a pro is doing.
His transition from amateur to pro, it was natural to him because ever since the age of 11, Miguel used to always tell me about his dream was to come out in a Banshee with the lights and the music. Miguel never had that amateur dream. So that's the reason he turned pro, because it was always in his heart to be a pro fighter. He didn't want to be no amateur fighter. If he would have been able to turn pro at the age of 10, I think he would have turned pro at 10. But that's illegal, you can't do that. But Miguel's always dream was to become a pro fighter.
You know, it's crazy how I have motivated this, you know, kid. Because that, you know, when he was a little kid, boxing, 10, 11 years old, you know, I always used to, you know, tell him, Miguel, you beat this, I give you this. You beat this, I give you this. You know, and he turned around and beat it, and I'm just going home, scratching my head. I promised him I was gonna get him this four-wheeler, and if he beat this tournament, and he did, now I gotta work overtime to get this. You know, when he turned open class, I said, if you beat these nationals, I guarantee you, you'll be going to school at 16 years old with a brand new car. Turn around and beat that. And I'm telling my wife, how am I gonna get this car now? And my wife said, well, you're gonna have to get it and this and that. So, you know, everything that I used to promise him and everything he used to promise me that he was gonna do, he always got. Yeah, people always used to ask me how they, you know, I named them No Fear. And I always tell them, I said, Miguel has no fear. This kid is like, he's not afraid of anything. I mean, he tries things, and I'd be afraid, and I'd be like, Miguel. And he said, no, Dad, it's okay. And Miguel doesn't care how big, how tall the guy is. He goes in there and he represent that name, no fear. When I'm saying no fear, he doesn't care. When that bell rings and the first punch lands, is about Miguel. You know, Miguel has no fear at all.
Yeah, a lot of people ask me, was Miguel ready for the pros? I said, this kid was born ready for the pros. You know, without a headgear, he was hurting kids. Every opponent he fought, he hurt. And when he told me what he wanted to get out the pros for his first fight, what he wanted to get cut. He wanted to feel the blood dripping down his eyes. And right there, I knew this kid is ready to turn pro. When he got cut his first time, this kid was so happy. It was like a badge of honor. He's like, look, how I got my first cut. He was so excited because he got cut from a headbutt. I mean, the kid is crazy.
I'm going to be world champion. Whether it kills me or not, I'm going to be world champion. This is just how I feel. This is the way I've felt forever. That's why I didn't go to the Olympics, because I didn't want to go that route. I wanted to be pro. I wanted to already have my name in lights. Everybody buying tickets, buying shirts, buying everything with my name on it. Just my name alone just makes me happy. Seeing my name on a main event card, HBO, Showtime, even ESPN or Comcast Sportsnet, anything. I love the fame. I like hearing people scream my name, tell me that, oh yeah, you this, you that. I like that. It motivates me. The more people notice me, the more motivated I get into doing everything else. I work hard. I can't speak for everyone else, but I know I work hard. I do whatever it takes, whatever my trainer wants me to do, whatever my manager wants me to do, whatever they want me to do, I get done, and some. I just came back from a little getaway with my family, and I was still working out over there. And it was a getaway. I was still working out. This is what I do. I work out. I work hard. Hard work. This is what I do. I just want to give a thanks to Mark Cipron, the new management. I'm very happy with all the stuff he's done for me so far. And we've only been working with each other for about a month and a half, 2 months. And he's just showed me a greatness. Amount of love and care and showing me that he actually cares about his fighter, that he cares about me. And this is not just a hobby for him, a new pickup line for him. This is something he wants to do, something he's treating this like it's his own family. Treating all his fighters, me, Ted, he just treat us with greatness. Trash. And I be getting it, getting it. I roll in my whipper and Bushy be loving it. Love, I get all of it. Hate, I get all of it. And I be getting it. Trash. Getting it. Trash. Getting it. Trash. Getting it. Trash. Trash. Getting it. Trash. Getting it. Trash. Getting it. Trash. Work, I put it in, yeah. Money, I get it in, yeah. Hear the studio grooving, my music is proving. I move your body, yeah. Fly, oh, easy, oh, yeah. Rhyme, okay, oh, yeah. Top to bottom, I'm ready. I rock them, I pop all the whipping, oh, yeah.